So if you want to reserve any time for rebuttal, you have 15 minutes total. So if you'd state your name for the record.
Yes, Your Honor. Burke Agapaga for the appellant.
Proceed, please.
May it please the court. Your Honor, this case is about it's a U.S. Constitution. We have to follow the separation of powers. And in my opinion, Department of Homeland Security cannot make up its own rules and delay cases and then press the removal button just to get rid of the case. In this case, there was an extreme delay, and the denial decision was so wrong that it required court not to dismiss this case. That's my basically argument, Your Honor.
I'm sorry, extreme delay, and what's the basis for your argument?
And the denial decision was so outrageous and arbitrary, the justification for the denial.
So why, what was the basis for the denial? Is it Mr. Guzman or Mr. Salguero?
Mr. Guzman, Your Honor.
Guzman, okay. So what was the basis for the denial of his application?
Your Honor, the basis was he had convictions between 16 and 23 years ago.
Well, he had 12 convictions, right? Then he had a pretty recent one, which was an aggravated felony, right?
That one, Your Honor, makes him ineligible. That's correct. But we're saying that because he was under investigation, basically DHS it's just the phrase ends justifying the means kind of approach.
So you're saying they, in essence, they dragged their feet.
Yes.
To get this aggravated felony into the record. Is that what
right,
you're saying?
Because he was under investigation. Now, what's crucial...
Are you making a due process argument?
You know, Your Honor, I would really like it if the DHS would say, you're under investigation. We would like to hear the results of that investigation, and we'll continue the case or file it again. But what they do is they make a denial decision, which is baseless. That's my argument, Your Honor. That's the due process argument. What's crucial here, Your Honor, in 2008, immigration judge gave a discretionary relief to my client with those convictions. He granted cancellation of removal. So after that, he picked up a standard DUI, and they're saying that that makes him ineligible, and they're denying it.
That's on naturalization.
Yes, Your Honor.
Okay. And you had two remedies. You had a 1421C remedy. You could appeal that determination, or you had a 1447B remedy. If they didn't do it in time, you could have gone to the district court.
Yes, Your Honor, but my client waited.
And you waited. So didn't you forfeit? Didn't you forfeit the 1447B remedy?
Well, Your Honor, that's the point. So what do we have to really do to avoid this abuse, Your Honor? That's my argument. So
probably what your client had to do was not pick up the aggravated felony and to file in time on the 1447B, right? That would have, I mean, both of those would have, if you're saying what would you have to do, those would be my two suggestions. But,
of course, Your Honor, he's ineligible. Of course, you should not have done it. But we were kind of trying to exhaust the remedies, and then it wasn't the exhaustion of remedies wasn't fully reached. That's why, and they did it in a way that we couldn't do anything. We did info passes. You know, that's back then you could go and ask the status of the case, so we had to do that. And the officer also told us at the interview when we did the N336, which is the review of the denial, he said that he sees no problem in the case and he's going to approve it. That's why we didn't go to court.
Now, your client was detained, right? Is your client gone now? Has your client been removed?
My client is not detained. He's out on bond, Your Honor.
Okay. So you would concede that with the aggravated felony, he's not eligible for naturalization?
Of course, Your Honor. That would be, I wouldn't argue against it.
All right. So what are you asking this court to do to benefit your client if he can't get naturalization? So what are you asking this court to do?
I'm asking that that the case should not have been dismissed, that this case should be remanded.
It's not dismissed by whom?
By the federal court. The federal court dismissed the case because the removal proceedings started. And my argument is that, Your Honor, the DHS simply shouldn't drag cases this long and just press the removal proceedings button. Then we don't have any checks and balances in the system.
Yeah, but is that even in front of us?
I'm sorry, Your Honor?
I mean, it's procedurally, this is a little bit of a mess. I mean, I'm not sure that what you're trying to accomplish is even in front of us. If you acknowledge that the aggravated felony is going to bar his naturalization.
Well, Your Honor, my argument is that he should have already been a citizen. We can't just tell people, wait for people to commit crimes, see if they're going to commit the crimes, and then see what will happen to them.
So what do you want us to do, as Judge Callahan asked?
The case should not have been dismissed, and I should have done discovery on the case.
Whether you should have gotten what?
Discovery on the case.
Even though you weren't timely?
Your Honor, we did info passes, and there was an officer.
Well, I guess you sort of opened with separation of powers. Okay, so if that's your opening here, then you have to ask us to do something that's in our wheelhouse. Because separation of powers means we don't color outside the lines in the executive or in in the legislative. I mean, we stay in the judicial. So it seems to me that you're saying you have to respect the separation of powers, and it seems like now you're asking us to color outside the lines to fashion a remedy for you.
I'm sorry if I was misunderstood, Your Honor. But what I'm trying to say...
What can we do within the lines that you're asking for?
I think the DHS intentionally delayed this case because he was under investigation.
Well, let's assume that's correct.
Yes.
Let's assume that you could prove that. What's that do with this case?
Because, Your Honor, if he's entitled to naturalization, there is no law that says if you're under investigation...
But you're asking for a naturalization which by necessity would have to ignore the aggravated felony. You want naturalization in 2019 or later, and you want to ignore what happened at the time of that aggravated felony.
I don't know how we can do that. I wouldn't ask for that. I just that the application was not done timely because it wasn't intentionally done timely. And for that, the court must allow us to at least do discovery. The case was flatly dismissed based on removal proceedings initiation. So I think that my client should find out if the Department of Homeland Security engaged in delay process intentionally, because there is no law that says that if
you... What would be your best case that if they did that intentionally, if they dragged their feet, what would be your best case that somehow that entitles your client to naturalization? Is there a case out there that says, even though he has an aggravated felony?
Well, that's after, Your Honor. I mean... People get naturalized and then they commit crimes. That doesn't make them denaturalized.
Essentially, you want nunk-pro-tunk back to pretend that he didn't commit an aggravated felony.
No, we're not pretending, but it was intentional delay. That's my point, Your Honor. And
want to save any time for rebuttal, see what the government says?
Sure.
Okay, then you can respond to that.
Okay.
Good
Good morning.
Good morning, Your Honor. May it please the Court, Aaron Goldsmith on behalf of the government. This is a somewhat unusual case in that plaintiffs have essentially admitted and conceded away their case. You asked opposing counsel whether or not his client is currently not eligible for naturalization, and his response, I believe, was of course. That is, he doesn't dispute that his client, the plaintiff doesn't dispute that he was convicted of health care fraud, that it's an aggravated felony, and that it renders him ineligible. That should be the end of the matter. The decision of the district court should be affirmed because he's seeking a review of a decision, an administrative decision, that by his own admission, he was not eligible for naturalization as the facts as they exist today. Thus he's not entitled to any relief from this court or any other court as a matter of law. There's nothing further for this court to decide.
It looks like, I think he may have been talking about Bellaharo versus Schultgen.
Yes, Your Honor.
Easy for me to say, but it seems like the district court may not have properly read that case. So what effect does that have on this proceeding?
Well, as a technical matter, it has no effect because he's conceded that he's not eligible for naturalization. So as a matter of law, he's not entitled to relief under 1421C. So I want to give you a substantive response to the whole issue of 1429, but just so that we're clear, as this court said in Levy Carey, courts aren't time machines. They don't go back and offer an opinion as the facts as they existed at some point in the past. So if by his own admission he's not eligible, that's it. The case should be affirmed regardless of this 1429C. It would be as if someone's applying for a permit and they admit that they weren't eligible for the permit. The proper remedy would be to dismiss the action. That has nothing to do with 1429. It's just they're not eligible.
But isn't his argument that he should have gotten naturalization at the time? And so if he had gotten naturalization at the time, then he would have been, when he was eligible for it, then none of the other stuff could have been considered.
It's sort of like Minority Report. They wouldn't have been able to say he was going to commit that crime in the future.
Well,
even if he was, it wouldn't have made him ineligible.
Right. I mean, that is his argument, but it's not correct. And the reason it's not correct is because courts don't offer advisory opinions on some hypothetical set of facts. They look at the facts as they exist, and as the facts exist, he is not eligible.
So backing up, is there even jurisdiction? I mean, that's been the lingering question in my mind, is why can't we just get rid of this case? He didn't file timely, so the district court didn't have jurisdiction. Am I misreading that?
There is an argument that the court lost or didn't have jurisdiction, but I just want to be clear that the key point was
that's what they call a softball. So tell them why that's not right.
Well,
I mean, he's saying you win.
Then I'm just going to say yes. I think that would be the appropriate.
Well, I make sure I'm right. I mean, I'm please pressure test this theory. But I mean, it seems to me like if we're trying to get from point A to point B, he's raised some convoluted arguments that would at least require us to spend a bit of time parsing through it. But why isn't the real answer, there's just no jurisdiction here?
Well, I don't think there is, but the,
well, why aren't you leading with that?
I thought there was a little bit ago.
So I mean, his whole argument is based on this hypothetical. Let's look at the facts that they existed before he was convicted. Before he was convicted, he was eligible. We don't believe he was ineligible, but that's a completely moot issue at this point. The whole question of whether or not he was eligible before he was convicted of health care fraud, in our view, the answer was no, he was not eligible. That's why we denied it.
You really want us to get to the merits here, don't you?
No, Your Honor. No, Your Honor. Our view is just the case was properly dismissed, and whether we don't have a preference in terms of whether it's a dismissal for lack of jurisdiction or
we kind of have a preference for the law.
Okay.
Okay. Not for the attorney's arguments. So that's what Judge Nelson is asking you. If the court did not have jurisdiction to hear the case, then that's the end of it.
That's the end of it. It should be dismissed, correct.
But I think when we make a more compelling argument than you do, we always scale back and think, like, well, what are we missing? And that's what we're trying to figure out. Why do you think there might be jurisdiction? Because it seemed like you were coming out guns hot on that.
Well, Your Honor, to the extent my focus was on the wrong thing, I apologize to the court. It was just that was something that was just brought up in oral argument, and that's what was on my mind. But the fact of the matter is, this case, for a whole host of reasons, should be dismissed. There's nothing, there's no issue for us to decide here.
You keep wanting to go past the jurisdictional issue. Mm-hmm. Why do you have to add the whole host of issues?
I don't, Your Honor. Okay, yeah. In that
I think
case,
that's what the court, my colleagues are trying to get you to focus on that jurisdictional question. Maybe I'll ask the question a different way. Is there any way that you can see that they could properly argue that the district court had jurisdiction of the 1447B claim?
No, there is no 1447B claim. And just to be clear, if you look at the complaint, he never raised anything about 1447B. Let me just point to, respectfully.
So it should be end of case, right?
That's the end of the case, yes.
All right. So
there is no 1447B.
All right. Let me get you into some conjecture then, since you have some time left.
Okay.
It just seems to me that if they're raising anything here that has any meat to it, it's that perhaps there was a due process violation by the government waiting and not acting. Can you see an argument like that could bring this 1447, bring some life back or jurisdiction back to the 1447B claim?
Respectfully, no, Your Honor, okay. Because there's no due process argument. There is no due process argument, one, and there's no due process basis for saying you have to have your application for naturalization decided in a certain number of days. What there is, as you alluded to earlier, is there's a legislative remedy. Congress has said if it's more than 120 days from the interview, you may, and that's the word Congress used, you may file an action under 1447B. Here they didn't. That's the end of the matter. And just to be clear, what the
just so that I understand this here, basically you're saying if that, say, 1447B did not exist, then the government could drag, you know, their feet or, you know, forever, and then people, you know, it. So then people could never get what they would be entitled to under the law. But what you're saying is 1447B is that if they take more than 120 days, then you have a way to push the matter forward, and they chose not to.
That's correct. Although I just want to add one.
Because appellant is arguing that the government is acting very unfairly and dragging things on, so just hoping that he'll stub his toe again or he'll be convicted of the aggravated felony. And, you know, if you look at his record, I mean, he already had, 11 convictions, so the likelihood that he would get another one if you wait long enough was pretty good. But that's not, but we don't want the government sitting on applications just to hope that someone stubs their toe.
Right, and Congress has already provided a remedy for that, which is, you just alluded to, 1447B. Even in the absence of that, arguably there might be some other remedy. Like if they had enacted 1447B, perhaps he could have brought an APA claim for undue delay. I don't know. That's kind of hypothetical at this point. But what is not hypothetical is, based on the facts of this case, there simply is no relief that he can be granted by this or any other court. And that's why the matter was properly dismissed. There's nothing further to decide. You hit the nail on the head when you talked about 1447B. That was a potential option, and that was something he did not avail himself of. That's all I have, Your Honor. Thank you.
Thank you. All right. It's your opportunity to respond. So why don't you come back with it, you know, if that 1447B is the arrow in your quiver to keep the government from dragging its feet, and you chose not to exercise it, so
yes, Your Honor.
How can you now claim that the government was dragging its feet?
I have the highest respect for the U.S. Attorney's Office. They're always professional. My problem is not the U.S. Attorney's Office, Your Honor. They have the highest standard But in this case, the 1447B wasn't filed because it's in my complaint. The officer said that he would approve the petition. That's why we were waiting for the approval.
It was not filed for what reason? I couldn't hear you.
That he would approve the petition.
The
immigration officer said he sees no problem in approving the petition, that he would approve it. So we have a very calculated pattern of basically not giving this person naturalization, and I think I should be entitled to...
But you rolled the dice and you lost.
I should be entitled to prove that, Your Honor. In court, my case should not have been dismissed.
Why does it matter what he said? I mean, you can't... There's no estoppel based on a government employee's statement. I don't care if he gave you a written statement saying that, well, yeah, we're going to approve it. I mean, if he doesn't approve it, he doesn't approve it. I mean, it's not done.
It's just that we're alleging that this was a calculated thing, and then he was the victim of it. And the court, Your Honor, may think that this is a very simple case, but it's not, because it involves calculated decisions made by the government, and I so submit, Your Honor. I think all of you understand, and I trust your decision, Your Honor. That's it.
Thank you both for your argument in this matter. This case will stand submitted.